It's another one of those heavenly stories. Lady died and she went to heaven, got to the pearly gates, and there was St. Peter. And so she stood there before him and she says, and he said, how are you? And she said, well, I'm okay. And she says, I guess I'm dead. And he said, yeah. She says, can I go through the gates? And he said, well, you can if you can spell one word for me. And she says, well, what is that word? He said, well, it doesn't matter. You can pick the word. And she said, well, I like the word love, L-O-V-E, love. And we practiced love on the earth when I was there, and it was just so wonderful. And everybody was just so filled with love. And so he said, okay, we'll let you in. But listen, I've got to go inside for a minute. Would you mind standing here at the gate for just a minute in case somebody comes while I'm gone? And if they are, just do the same thing I did. And she said, okay, I'll be glad to. Well, the next thing you know, there pops up a man right in front of her. And guess who it is? It's her ex-husband. And he looks at her and she says, how did you get here? And he said, well, I guess I had a heart attack. And he said, well, what do I do to get in the gates? And she says, well, you just have to spell one word. And he said, what's that word? And she said, Czechoslovakia. Lots of love. And all of us love words, and we have words that we love to hear more than any other. Probably the word we like to hear most of all is our own name, except when our mama calls us to fuss at us. But we love to hear our name because it's nice to know that somebody can say your name and even pronounce it right. And it's a wonderful feeling because, hey, somebody knows my name. I think there was a TV program on there about a place that we won't mention where everybody knew your name. And I hope that that really applies to here in church, that everybody knows your name because we love each other and we care about each other. And it means something. And not only our own name, but sometimes there are those terms of endearment that we really like to hear, like, you know, sweetheart or darling, and they really sound good. Mickey and Sylvia put out a record back, I think it was in the late 50s, in which Mickey asked Sylvia, says, Sylvia, how do you call your man when you want him? And she said, oh, I say, lover boy, and what if he doesn't answer? And she says, well, I say, hey, lover boy, and what if he still doesn't answer? And she says, I say, baby, my sweet baby. Yeah, I wish I could sing that good. It was a neat song. Husbands and wives and other sweethearts, you know, they have their terms of endearment. I think the one that Clarice most likely likes to hear the most is probably darling, because it has a real long history with us. In fact, it is the very first term of endearment that I spoke to her. So she remembers that, and I have to remember it. And I think that the term of endearment is more than just a little word that I like the best, I think, when Clarice says it, and it's, you're my hero. You're my hero. Which comes from that song, Wind Beneath My Wings. And it's words we love to hear. And the words I love to hear from congregation comes mostly from the mouth of children, and I really love it. It's Brother Jim. Brother Jim. Listen, I don't think I was ever called Brother Jim until I got here. I don't ever remember being called Brother Jim. I mean, they call me Brother Wismer, and they call me all kinds of things before. But Brother Jim, and to listen to it from these kids, and boy, some of them can say it so melodically and innocently and with such a beautiful just lilt to it. And it just makes you feel like you're 10 feet tall sometimes. You know, words can mean so much to us when they're spoken with all sincerity. And there are a lot of words in the Bible that really stand out and fill our hearts with joy. And there's a phrase that is repeated three times and three times only in the New Testament. It's said in other words, but in this particular phrase, it only appears these three times, and they're all in salutations, twice in the epistles of Paul and once in the epistle of Jude. And they're, to me, probably the most comforting words in the world, terms of endearment that come straight from God. And when you read and understand these words, they should make you want to fly higher than an eagle, to get way up there and soar, to make you feel wonderful. Now, I don't know the ultimate word for joy, but I know quite a few synonyms. There's always happiness and delight and pleasure and enjoyment and bliss and ecstasy and elation and joyfulness and gladness and thrill. And the phrase we're going to look at today is one that thrills my soul. It thrills me all the way down to the very core of my being and fills me up completely. The phrase is the title of our sermon this morning. It's called Loved by God. Loved by God. Only appears three times and always in those salutations. First time we see it is in Paul's epistle to the Romans in chapter 1 and verse 7. And it also adds something else to it. God, we are loved by God, and He called us. He called us. Let's read. To all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I don't think it gets too much better than that when we really understand it and we see this as terms of endearment that God has written to us. It was written to those first century Romans, but it comes to us too. Now Paul was always careful in the words he chose. And he was careful here. It wasn't just frivolous words. It wasn't just that he's got to open it up some way. When you're in school, and of course kids are learning in English and everything, how to write a letter and everything, sometimes they learn how to use words and how to end the letter. And dear so-and-so is how we often start the letters. We end them with sometimes truly yours or sincerely yours or love or however. And sometimes we just do that. They don't really have great meaning. But we have to understand here, these words have great meaning. Think about it. Loved by God. We are loved by God. Now, I don't know if that means much more to you than many of our little old trite cliches, like that one, have a good one. I'm cynical sometimes. It's gotten old and it ought to be thrown away, and somebody ought to come up with something new anyway. And besides that, I always thought, why in the world didn't they ever finish it? Have a good what? But anyway, we have all the trite ones. This isn't. And I hope that you pick it up as more than that. They're not just words to fill a page. They're not just words to be bannered about. Simply because we feel that we need to say something. Paul, again, was careful. And he was guided by the Holy Spirit of God. And what he said was the Word of God. The Word of God. So these were words to the Roman Christians. They needed to hear it. And they're words to us, and we need to hear it. We are loved by God. by God. And who says so? God says so. God tells us that. We are loved by Him. Now, if you take a walk down the road through Pity City, or you walk down memory lane and some of your old sins pop to your mind, you may momentarily think, how could God love me? Listen, don't ever stay there. Get out of that place as quick as possible. You don't want to even think that way. That's where the devil wants you to stay, not God. And so you want to recall these words and remember it and think on it. We are loved by God, and that's the truth. Now, if you need to repent, repent and move on, because you are loved by God. Don't be like the lady who loved revivals. Oh, she loved revivals and went to everyone the church had. And she was saved at every one of them. And not only was she saved at everyone, she was wearing the old preacher out with her insistence of being baptized every time that she came forward. Well, one day, one of the cynical teenagers, you know, you cynical teenagers sitting back there, one of the cynical teenagers, or practical teenagers, we might better say, because I know that I'm one of those cynical fellows too. That's why I can say that. But one of the cynical teenagers, he popped up and he said, "Hey, preacher," he said, "why don't you hold her down a little longer this time and maybe it'll take?" He knew that woman's hypocrisy. He knew how she was. Yeah. Do it again. You know, we don't need to be saved again or baptized again and again and again and again, as if the first one didn't count or it didn't take, or because we were too young or we didn't really understand. God didn't tell us that we had to understand. He said you have to believe and obey. That's what you have to do. But it's good when you can understand. But you don't have to go through it over and over again. You see, baptism's an act of obedience, of doing what God has told us to do. And that's what it's about. Peter said, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ." And in the New Testament, the only ones that were ever rebaptized again, were some of John's disciples, because they only knew John's baptism, and it was a baptism for the forgiveness of sin. And Peter had them rebaptized, or it was Paul, had them rebaptized, so that indeed they were baptized into the name of Jesus Christ. Because it's Jesus Christ who saves us. And so that was the difference, and the only time that ever occurred. Now, we repent, and that's what we may need to do sometimes. We repent because we know that we're loved by God. And we know that God will forgive our sins. That's a wonderful thing to know. It's not, I go to God and I pray, "God, will you forgive my sins?" We ask Him, "Please forgive our sins." And we have confidence and assurance that we know what? He's going to do it. He's going to do it. If we repent. If we do a little changing. Sometimes a whole lot of changing. But the point is that we're loved by God. And He forgives us. The point we're trying to get across here is that we don't have to do something magical, nor do we have to do something to earn God's love. If we're in Christ, we're loved by God. And I'm going to use that word that sometimes I cringe at when I hear other people use it real lightly. It's a good word, and it has meaning, and it should be used when it's talking about the divine and not about something really nice that happens to us, but we use it anyway, and I never say anything. But here's the word. We're loved by God, and that is just awesome to think about. It is really awesome. It's the only thing I know of that's awesome, is that God loves us. God loves us. The God who created the whole universe loves me, His creation, despite the fact that I'm flawed. He loves me. You know, many women get abortions because the doctors say that the child they're bearing is going to have Down syndrome, and they don't want to deal with a flawed child. Listen, we're all flawed children, but we're still loved by God. We're still loved by God. And God wants people to be saved. He loves them. He wants to live with them throughout all eternity. Now, I guess that we could go to our neighbors sometimes and ask if we're good neighbors and if people like living next door to us. And maybe here on this world, sometimes we may find some that don't like living next door to us. But listen, God's going to have us living next door to Him. Wow. And He loves us. And we need to remember that. He loves us. Oh, so much. Now, He has called us also to be His saints. Now, that word saints, of course, has been used all wrong and everything else, and we won't get into too much of that. But the point is, saints are not saints are not just a football team. And saints are not just super Christians who stand head and shoulder above the rest. Listen, we are all saints, which means we all live holy lives. And we're truly loved by God. And He's given us what? Grace and peace. God's love is expressed in the grace that He's given us. We live by faith, not by law. And we receive God's peace, which surpasses all understanding. Paul writes these as reminders to us of just how much God loves us. Truly, we're loved by God. The next verse that reminds us that we're loved by God is found in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 4. And He loved us and He chose us. He chose us. For you know, brothers, loved by God, that He has chosen you. Now, when I was a boy, we played a lot of baseball on Saturdays down at the school when I lived near the school. Down at the school, and the kids just seemed to always gather there. And we'd get together and we'd choose teams. And of course, the best players were always chosen first. And then they'd finally get down to the rest of us. And they'd say, well, I guess you can be on our team. I guess you can be on our team. Well, we were all chosen. But let me tell you, some of us didn't always really feel like we were chosen, because we were chosen reluctantly. But God doesn't choose like people do. He doesn't pick favorites. He doesn't pick the best. He chooses us all in Jesus Christ, all who belong to Him. God chooses, and we know God loves us because He chooses us, and He wasn't reluctant when He did it. Because Paul reminds us in the next verse, 1 Thessalonians 1:5, our gospel came to you not simply with words, but also with power and the Holy Spirit and deep conviction. Listen, it wasn't just because words we speak. It's never the words we speak. that we always have to understand that there is the power of God behind it, not because of some person and who he is, but simply because it's God's word. And it's God's word that's preached, and it's God's word that has the power. And so that's what he's saying here. It was the power. It was the power of the Holy Spirit when we preached. And that's what makes the difference in you. Not just simply words. But words are important because that's how we convey our feelings and our thoughts. Now, the divine God was and is involved in preaching and teaching and in the way we live. And there is divine power in the Word. As the Holy Spirit convicts us of sin, and that's what Scripture says, the Holy Spirit convicts us of sin. So I think sometimes maybe preachers just carry on a little bit too much because they think that they have to convict somebody of sin when it's not them. It's the Holy Spirit that convicts them of sin through the preached word. Through the preached word. And as the Holy Spirit works in us, we know his power. Because he works in us to produce fruit, that fruit of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And when the Holy Spirit is in work in us, he doesn't just do a superficial job. He doesn't do a job just for show, so that on the outside we seem to be holy people who love God. He doesn't do that, but instead, what does he do? He goes down in the very depths of us and he changes our hearts. He changes our hearts. And the only way he won't change your heart is when you harden it. God was really upset sometimes when people hardened their hearts, as they did in the wilderness. They hardened their hearts, but no, he gives us new hearts. Our old selfish ways have been buried with Christ, and the meanness has been washed away, and kindness has replaced it. Look, we become forgiving, merciful, gracious, and kind. And that's what Paul sees in them, and he knew that they were loved by God. And when I look out at you, I see that same thing. I can see that you're loved by God. Are we perfect? No. Not in the worldly sense, but we are maturing in Christ. And your grace, it grows deep inside of you. And it's expressed in the kindnesses that you show. You know, we know that you're loved by God. And he's chosen you for eternal life in his presence. Wow. Loved by God. And the next one, verse we want to look at that reminds us that we are loved by God is found in Jude, verse 1 and 2. And we are not only loved by God, but we are kept by God. We are kept. Listen. Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and a brother of James, to those who have been called, who are loved by God the Father and kept by Jesus Christ. Mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. So Jude not only points out that we're loved by God, that we're kept by Jesus. And again, I'm reminded of that ball field again. As a kid, 10 to 12 years old, there we were gathered one Saturday. And we were short a man. And there was a girl there. Now listen, when you're 10, 11, 12, you understand. It was a girl. You can't say it any gnarlier. It was a girl. And she was there and she wanted to play. And we picking teams and sure enough we were short one. And she says, well, can I play? And at first they said no, and then they took the field and realized they needed somebody. So they said, okay, girl, you can come play. And they stuck her out in right field. Listen, all the bad players go to right field or as catcher. In those days, that's the way it was. You're either in right field or you were a catcher. So they stuck her in right field, and the other team came up to bat, and they made one out. And all of a sudden, a guy shows up. And immediately they fired the girl and put the boy out in right field. In other words, hey, she was chosen, but she wasn't kept. God chooses us, and He keeps us. He keeps us. And none of our sins, little sins, basic sins, will stop Him from loving us and stop him from saving us. Now, that doesn't mean that we can't make a determination in our own hearts that we don't like God anymore. And we don't want anything to do with Him anymore. Scripture has words about that and speaks and warns about falling away. Falling away. And that's why we're told to be faithful to the end. But it's about faith. It's not about works. And it's not about sin. It's about God's love, because Jesus overcame sin. Of course, Scripture says you don't do it, though. You don't sin. And we don't want to sin. Listen, God loves us. And He keeps us to the end. He keeps us. He doesn't throw us back because somebody better comes along. Catch that? Have you ever had that happen to you? You may even have had a job and somebody better came along. And you lost your job because somebody else better was there. You may have had a friend. And y'all were playing nicely and having a good time. But somebody better came along and she threw you away and wanted to play with somebody else. That happens. God doesn't throw us away. We're not in competition. We're chosen on the basis of our faith in Jesus Christ. And we need to keep that faith to the end. Now, for those who feel down and who feel left out, these are great and comforting words. And don't ever forget them. You're loved by God, and Jesus keeps us, and we are recipients of mercy and peace and love, and not just a little bit, but in abundance. And when it says in abundance, if you've ever seen a picture of a cornucopia, it always has those fruit and vegetables coming out the end down there towards it, being poured out. And the idea is that Horn of Plenty is going to always supply those things for you and always be able to pour them out. Well, that's the same kind of thing that you need to realize. It's always there. That peace and that grace and that mercy. And it's always that abundant. Christians need to hear these words. The Christians in the first century needed to hear it, and we do. We do. So as you go through the trials of life, and especially you young folks, remember, as the trials come, you're loved by God. You know what? I had a nephew, meaner than a snake. pestered his sister and his aunt.